So I'm super, super pleased by the fact that The Rebel is a proper spy drama. Enjoyment. Pure enjoyment. The Rebel is a 43-episode drama that's being aired in China right now on both the web platform iQIYI and the satellite television station CCTV 8. The drama is directed by Zhou You and led by Zhu Yilong, Tong Yao, Wang Zhiwen, Wang Yang, Zhang Zixian, and many, many, many other people. It is based on a medium-length novel written by the author Bi Yu. It's been updated 2 episodes per day. So as it went live on the 7th, it will literally finish airing within this month. At the moment I'm shooting this video, I have watched the first 16. As this video goes out, it would have aired into the 20 number episodes. Hopefully nothing weird happened to this drama by that point. I'm gonna give this drama a 2 goat mine rating. If the drama continues with its narrative quality, its storytelling quality, as what I've seen in the first 16 episodes, it's gonna be at least a 2 goat mine. If it does something exceeding my expectation, not saying it cannot get a 3 goat mine, and I would be very happy if that happens. So as usual, I'll tell you the good things and the bad things about this drama, and I'll reverse the order because most of the things, like 90% of the things about this drama, is on the positive side. Before that though, some general introduction to the story itself. Like I said at the beginning, this is based on a medium form novel that only has 50,000 Chinese characters. If you translate that into English, it would be around 30,000 English words. It's a really short novel. It gets translated into 43 episodes of drama. The first thing you'll think about is it gonna be really draggy and watered down? Nope. The scriptwriters did a lot of extension and enrichment of the original text. The story starts in the year 1936, and it will run, if it's exactly like the book, over a decade long. It will cover the entirety of Japanese Sino War and after the war, leading into People's Republic of China's founding. So that's quite a big span of time. We will come across many, many different political parties. So it does require a little bit knowledge on the audience's side, particularly international audiences, if you want to go into this drama to know who is who and who is for what. The most obvious would be Japanese versus Chinese, so all the Chinese people against the Japanese. But then there will also be traitors on China's side. And then within China, there are power struggles between the Communist Party and Kuomintang. Kuomintang or the KMT or KMD, depending on how you translate that into English. And within the Kuomintang, there's also divisions between different sides. Like, it gets complicated, particularly after in the story when Shanghai is occupied by Japanese, then it gets more complicated. If you've watched the drama The Disguiser back in 2015, that's produced by Zhong Yangguang and led by Hu Ge and Wang Kai and Jin Dong, it's pretty much the same kind of setup in terms of what are the power parties in this drama and why they're fighting against each other. And we will come into this drama following our main character played by Zhu Yilong, Lin Nansheng. In the drama, he starts as somebody who is just a trainee at a spy school, and then he gets selected because he's very good to work in Shanghai's division. And he will go through many, many challenges and many things, and he will also experience the turbulent time, and it will push him to different sides of things, and obviously, eventually, he will end up on the red side. Now, let me talk about first the tiny, tiny bit of things that are not ideal. To be honest, this drama really doesn't have significant shortcomings in my opinion. It is something personally that I prefer to see and this drama doesn't offer, which is the overall style, which would include its visual language, how it gets edited together, camera language, color palette, that side of things. I feel it is too standard. It is a very drama. It doesn't have any flair of individual design of things. Think about last year's Fearless Whispers. It has strong stylistic look. The color palette, the way it's told, it has that cinematic look of it. I'm not saying it's as video-y as, say, the early 2000s dramas, but with today's technology, camera, the possibilities that you can play in post-production, it really is not that hard if you want to give it a very memorable, distinctive look. But this drama doesn't have it. It's super, super drama standard look. I'd prefer, personally, to have a little bit more on the aesthetic side. Then let's talk about the good things. And within that, I will mention a little bit things that's, again, very personal that I feel it could do better. First and foremost, and most important, this is a proper traditional spy drama. When I say that, it's not like Chinese drama that hasn't produced many Republic of China setting spy dramas in recent years, but none of them really, really can be considered as an exciting, traditional, plot-heavy, the mouse and cat game, that type of spy drama. None of them can really be called that. Even last year's quite successful Fearless Whispers, it's a very different angle spy drama where spy plot is not really the major chunk of the drama. The other ones are pretty embarrassing in quality storytelling. The Sniper, led by Huang Xuan, wasn't happy about that. Even earlier with Wan Qian and Chen Kun, Tuo Shen, that drama also doesn't quite work. Jing Zhe, Awakening of the Insects with Zhang Ruoyun and Wang O, that drama, it fails halfway. Even that drama with like Qin Junjie and Xu Lu, can't even remember its name. Also, just like spy. Not exciting. Logic sometimes just fails completely and people do things that just does not fit into its timing or all of that. So for a really exciting, well-written logic, all works out, characters are all intelligent, and this is the first one that I can actually sit down and watch and not double speed through it and actually have to pay attention to what shows up on screen. And sometimes you even need to stop and think about what they've just done to realize, oh, okay, so this person is laying the trap for that person that will be pulled up later. I haven't had that experience for a long time. So I'm super, super pleased by the fact that The Rebel is a proper spy drama. And particularly, I like the fact that our leading character, played by Zhu Yilong in Nansheng, is not a godsend Superman. Often you come across this type of lead characters in spy drama who are just overtly lucky. And carrying a huge hero's halo with them, it's like everywhere they go, plot armor, they don't get hurt, they don't get into trouble. I like the fact that our male lead character, by this point, really still hasn't achieved anything significantly prominent in the plot. He's not given any special treatment for no good reason from his superiors. He's not the person who miraculously saves the day. I haven't seen that really in this type of drama again for a long time, that respects the reality of things, the laws of physics, and respect audience's intelligence. And as story writing, it's also correct that you want to set up a main lead character as somebody the audiences will identify with, all his enemies, all the things against him, and all the challenges he faces are hard. Kind of entails great sacrifice and prices on his side. Like, that makes the story more interesting, and the bad guys are cruel so that our main character's struggle becomes worthwhile. The second point that I love about this drama is, oh, such good acting. Although this drama, when it's promoted, you know it's led by Zhu Yilong and Tong Yao. Once you start watching the drama, particularly the early episodes, they really are not dominant at all. Zhu Yilong's role, Ling Nansheng, is definitely the main lead actor. But even if that's the case, he's not significantly, predominantly the person holding the screen time. This is between an ensemble drama and a definitive lead drama. And you see how good the entire cast is. Wang Zhiwen, one of the most veteran actors working today in China, and honestly speaking, he would be one actor in this entire crew who is probably qualified to teach other actors acting. One of the best line delivery person in the entirety of Chinese film and drama land. When I first saw that he is one of the main cast last year, I was like, oh, okay, this drama is probably gonna be good. Then the other actor, Wang Yang, who also at this point has just exited the narrative for a while, and he will come back later in the drama. I also have been noticing him for over a decade. He is not high profile. He really hardly ever leads a drama. He's so good. The two Wangs of this drama, the actors, are just like blessing to this drama. He plays this very cocky, very confident, super intelligent, and super good at doing his work leader of the Shanghai division. And there's not even 1 second or one moment when he's on screen that he didn't do a good job. Everything he does, oozing with dramatic tension. Then the other actor supporting role that I highly, highly appreciate is the actor Zhang Zixian. If you've watched Bureau of Transformers, the animal turning into human drama that was pretty wild, you probably have noticed him. This is one of the golden supporting roles because he doesn't stand out, you know, look-wise as one of the most good-looking actors out there. But when he is in any drama, he's just, like, gives you the feeling that he's the perfect person for it. He just fits it like it's tailored for him. For all the scenes this actor has, which mostly happens between him and Wang Zhiwen or Wang Yang, he never drops the ball. When he's facing all of those actors, he's as good. Perfect acting. And particularly because between these three roles, they are the higher ups. So there are so much happening underneath the surface. There's so much bureaucracy, but also like clever thinking and planning and people trying to figuring out what's the other person about going on. Every line between them back and forth is delicious to watch. And then there are many other roles who would just show up for a bit and then disappear. This drama just covers so many different characters, and each and every one of them is individually interesting. Great acting and great writing at the same time happening on screen. Just enjoyment. Pure enjoyment. Now, about the not so ideal part in the ideal part of the points, which is because the supporting roles are all very well written and so well played by all the actors, it actually made the two leads looking less good. So for the leading actor Zhu Yilong and leading actress Tong Yao, I'm not saying they're not doing a good job and they don't affect my enjoyment of the drama at all, they don't pull me out of the story at all, and I am really looking forward to their development. But so far within the first 16 episodes, I really have to say, in comparison to the much older, more experienced actors in this drama, their performance kind of shows that they still have a distance to go. For my dear long-time audiences of my channel, you know, 2018 Guardian, Zhu Yilong, you know what it means to me and how much stuff I've done. I have a filter and cannot ignore it, so I put extra attention on, say, Bai Yu or Zhu Yilong or even other supporting role actor actresses who are part of the production. I watch pretty much everything that these leading actors have done, although Reboot I haven't managed to watch through it. Can't continue because it's boring. But pretty much everything else I've seen Zhu Yilong done since then, and then his older stuff I've dug out and watched most of it. So I am so familiar with this actor that I have noticed multiple times recent years that he has kind of fallen into a very habitual way of acting. He has a standard procedure of doing certain things, certain emotions, certain reactions. That is so anticipatable. I don't know if that's a word. I can pretty much 99% predict how he's gonna act in a particular scene. I'm like, yeah, he's gonna flutter his eyelashes, he's gonna look down, he's gonna bite his teeth, and he does that. I don't know if that's a good thing for an actor or not so good. Or maybe it's just me who's watched too much of this actor, so I'm too familiar. So in this drama, I'd say he's doing an okay job, but nothing of his acting has in any way delivered me any level of surprise. I always look forward to familiar actors and actresses breaking through, stepping out of the comfort zone. Give me something I totally didn't expect, but we're not at the end of the drama yet. Original novel does write this character as a quite gone through a lot of changes and a lot of different stages character. At this point, still pretty much in his initial stage of a character development. But later, there's gonna be significant changes happening to his character if the script is generally following the original text. So there's still possibility of me being surprised by his acting later. As for the leading actress Tong Yao, she's also doing an okay job, particularly around the episode 10 to 14 when she encounters her biggest challenge yet in this drama. I do see a level of acting that I am happy with. But for the other parts that are so not plot-wise exciting, it's just okay. And unfortunately, the Bai Yulan, the White Magnolia Award, just happened in China. She is the person who won the Best Actress. And honestly, internet's opinion are 99% that I can see everywhere is like, it shouldn't be her. And I agree. I think the actress should getting the leading actress award this year should be Ruo Yizha from Shanghai Qing. And I think most people agree with that. And a lot of people think that actress got robbed. And for a lot of complicated reasons. Like many awards, you know, it has spaces to maneuver because of all kinds of power and money and behind it. So, and unfortunately, that just happened. And then she got the award and she's the leading actress of this drama. So I don't know. Like, it's just coincidental. I never thought of her as one of the best actresses out there, but she's not bad either. So I still need the later episodes of her acting to 100% form an opinion about her acting in this drama. But so far, I would just give her a satisfactory rating. So for the two leading actor actress, by no means saying they're not good, just in comparison to great supporting roles, they appear to be less good. Honest opinion, don't know if that's gonna get me murdered, but like I said, I'm always gonna be honest in my reviews. That should conclude my first impression of the drama, The Rebel Panijo. It is the best spy drama I've seen this year, and probably in the last 2 or 3 years of this particular genre as a standard traditional exciting plot heavy, no wasted moments, no dragginess, everybody is intelligent as they are supposed to be, drama. And I'm very happy, very very happy that this drama exists, and I'll definitely stick till the end. And I wish the later episodes are gonna be even better. I don't know if they're gonna adapt it to the point that they significantly change many characters' fate. If not, okay, if they stick to it pretty much, my warning to you would be get ready. Many of them will go out. Maybe in the ban, but they will go out. In China, there is a saying about Mingguo, Republic of China setting, films and dramas, which is 十个民国九个杯还有一个化成灰, okay? Which is, if there are 10 stories that's set in Mingguo, 9 of them will end up in tragedy and the one left over got burned into ashes. Get prepared for ashes and burning and knives and tears and death and bullets and explosions and I'm just happy that I live in 21st century. Thank you for watching UpNewX. I'll see you in my next video. Meanwhile, live long and happy drama watching.